good portion of the season, early season, they were wearing black and gold uniforms, but for a middle section, they didn't look like Penguins, but they've gotten back to Pittsburgh Penguin ice hockey, certainly in their last three games, as we joined Stoggy and Bob on the island. You know, one of the conversations, guys, was lack of secondary scoring. Well, Chris Kunitz wouldn't be considered secondary scoring, but there comes a time when anybody not named Sid Gino or real deal James Neal scoring from any one of those guys is more than welcome, and they got a boatload Sunday from Chris Kunitz.
They sure did, Stan. And you think about it, Kunitz had 26 goals last year. He had a great year, so he is a guy who can put the puck in the net. But he's the first guy since Mario in 1985, New Year's Eve of 85-86, to score four goals on four shots in a game, Bob. A special performance for sure.
Yeah, he gets credit with four shots on net. But the first one, as we see off a faceoff, was a redirection. This was credited the day after. Clearly, he redirected that in. But Chris Kunitz got out to a little bit of a slower start on the offensive side of things. I think he was a little bit peeved by a couple of body checks that he was called for boarding, but he's got into those little soft areas, those James Neal type areas, and Kunitz has become a sharpshooter.
Scoring goals is something we expect from the Penguins. Preventing them is something we hope for from the Penguins as we go forward in this truncated season on the way to the Stanley Cup playoffs. And only four goals against in the last three games, that's playing some pretty good defense, Bob.
Well, I think the Penguins' defense is just structured perfectly right now. You got a guy like Chris Letang. He's been on the ice with a guy like Simone Dupre. And those two have complemented each other beautifully, the two Frenchmen. And Chris Letang has controlled pucks. He's got into the high slot areas, you see. And he's taken his time. He's got his shot on the net, which we all love, of course, Staggy. And Chris Letang now, when you talk James Norris, once again, Chris Letang, his name goes in that pot.
We talked about these two guys going into the game last week against the New York Islanders, and both of them scored a goal. The Penguins are aware of them. We were aware of them. Sometimes it doesn't matter how aware you are. They still can burn you, Bob.
Well, when you go to a Greyhound race, you see guys like, or dogs like Michael Grabner. Certainly not a dog in the National Hockey League. He is a stud. Number 40, when he's gone, he's gone. And John Tavares has now become an elite player in the National Hockey League. His chemistry is undeniable with Matt Molson. 64 straight Molson goals he's on the ice for.
In just a moment, Dan Potash will visit with the man who scored four goals in one game on Sunday afternoon. Chris Kunitz is our guest. Penguins and Islanders.
Well, the Penguins find themselves on the island tonight where they look to extend their winning streak to four games against the Islanders here on Root Sports. And, Chris, it's no secret that you've been under the weather the last few games, but you've also scored four goals in that span. First of all, are you feeling better? Secondly, is it a good thing if you are?
The puck's been going in. Team's been playing well, feeling better, but we still got to go out there and work hard. These guys took it to us in our own building last game. They had better special teams than we did, so we got to go out and play hard tonight.
Now, what did you learn from that experience? I know it was just one game and one matchup, but in terms of special teams, how do you counter that tonight?
They break it down for us. We have to, you know, exploit different parts of the area, the ice that didn't work last time, and our PK's got to be a little better against their guys. They made some four or five crisp passes. We didn't seem to do that on the power play, so we just got to be better.
Chris, thank you.
All right, thanks.
Gentlemen.
All right, thank you, Dan. And as usual, our next order of business is our Toyota lineup, Bob. And boy, it's starting to look pretty good, pretty solid.
Well, it is. Sidney Crosby, Pascal Dupuis spoiled the shutout on Nabokov. Kunitz coming off a four-game performance. There's Zach Poychuk looking for his first point as a Penguin with Evgeny Malkin in the center and James Neal. Matt Cook got his first against his ex-team, the Caps. Brandon Sutter in the middle and Tyler Kennedy. That's your third line. Here's the fourth. Tanner Glass looking for his first point in a Penguin uniform. Joe Vitale, third in the National Hockey League in faceoffs.
And there's the blue line of Brooks Orpik, Paul Martin, that defensive pairing that we have come to love, the shutdown pair. Simone Dupre and Chris Letang, the top two defenders for the Penguins. And Derek Englund with Robert Bortuzzo on a scoring streak.
So revenge on the minds of that lineup here tonight as the Pittsburgh Penguins meet the New York Islanders in just a moment.
The quest for the cup starts right here.
20,000 people behind the card working for you. Buy Toyota. Now's the time to go places with Toyota. Visit buyatoyota.com for special offers.
And by Sports Yapper. Go yap about tonight's game on Sports Yapper. Free on all iPhones, iPads, and Androids.
So, the Pittsburgh Penguins and New York Islanders match it up again, and, they're going to do it five times this year. This is the second of five, and Sidney Crosby is on fire right now with four goals, 13 points. Starting to play his game, and Franz Nielsen, as usual, had the assignment of going head-to-head with him. As we begin the hockey game, Nielsen playing with Kyle Okposo and Michael Grabner. Brian Strait on defense, along with Mark Streit. Strait and Streit teamed up, and the Penguins at the Crosby line, of course. Dupuis and Kunitz, Paul Martin and Brooks Orpik on defense. Penguins want to manage the puck better than they did against the Islanders in Pittsburgh. They want to get it deep against them. They know that they have dangerous forwards. They don't want to hand them any scoring chances. They can create enough on their own. Here's Sidney Crosby with it. Crosby and Dupuis out here working, and Franz Nielsen still looking for his first goal on the year. Brings it out to center. Michael Grabner shoots it long. Fleury, who's had a tremendous record on the road so far, 2-0 with a .96 goals against average, and on the road. So the numbers don't look so good at home, although he finally got that first home win against the New Jersey Devils over the weekend. Now Matt Cook pushing the puck to the corner, and Andy McDonald back to play it. Cook, Sutter, and Kennedy. Penguins third line on the ice. Tavares moves it ahead to center. Tavares can't get around Simon Dupre. Good stick there for the rookie defenseman of the Penguins. And now Travis Hamonic back, and round for McDonald. He tried to get it out, and he will work it past Tyler Kennedy. Now it's Tavares for Molson. Molson throws it to the net. Right through the paint. Just past the right leg of Fleury.
Boy, that puck looked offside, I'll tell you. I mean, right side was way off there as Tavares was trying to get the blue line, and in my opinion, let's have to take a look at that.
Molson's shot. That one just missed the net.
Oh boy.
That
just missed.
Malkin takes over. Evgeny Malkin and Sidney Crosby, neither one of them has ever scored a goal against Evgeny Nabokov. They're both aware of that going into this game tonight. Let's see if that has any a bearing on that stat. As James Neal takes it, moves it back on defense. Adam Malkin.
26 shots you talk about when you talk about Malkin and Crosby against Nabokov.
Nabokov sweeps one aside, and Thomas Olmstrom, David Olmstrom, moves it back off the glass into the Penguins zone, taken there by Robert Bortuzzo, and he backhands it off the boards and up into the Islanders zone.
A lot of line matching going on right now. They want Hamonic and McDonald against the top line of the Penguins, and that'd be the Malkin line. That's what they're looking for, the Islanders.
Tanner Glass shoots it long. Nabokov steers it aside. Adams now for Tanner Glass. Marty Reasoner leans on him. Glass works the wall nicely. Penalty coming up. Going to be against the New York Islanders as Fleury went to the bench. A holding call coming up, and the Penguins will put their power play to work. If you remember in that game in Pittsburgh, the Penguins had a couple of power play chances in the first period. And they did not connect on them. It might have been a different hockey game if they did. Let's see what they can do with this one early here.
This is the play on Tavares looking to the right side. Is this offside? Maybe not. A little bit of drag of the skate on the right side, and you see the penalty here. The hold as Tanner Glass was wrapped up by Marty Reasoner.
Great work by Glass to draw that penalty, and now the Islanders win the draw, but Crosby intercepts on the clearing attempt. Neal with it, shoots and scores! James Neal connects with another one, another power play goal. His sixth overall of the season, and all of them have been scored on the road.
Now both of these teams are doing their damage on the road. The Penguins are 5-1. The Owls are 3-1-1. Fantastic to see James Neal back on the board. He led the National Hockey League with 18 power play goals. This one hard, low, right under the right pad of Evgeny Nabokov. Neal had not been shooting the puck enough. Only six shots in his last four games. That's kind of just average for a hockey player, not for a guy that was second in the National Hockey League in shots last year behind Malkin. So they were 1-2.
That's his third power play goal of the season. Matt Carter just got nailed by Matt Cook in the corner. Robert Bortuzzo to the puck. Bortuzzo with his head up, goes across ice, angling quickly shot it in, but it came out over the blue line, and it's going to be offside. So James Neal goes five hole on Evgeny Nabokov. You saw Kartner, he went down like a ton of bricks.
Well, a little bit of payback right there. Remember Kartner punching Matt Cook in the head at the end of the last game between these two teams. And Kartner got kind of caught flat-footed. Am I going to go back to my right? Am I going to go to the left? Matt Cook. Well, he just had a beeline right for Matt Kartner, and he made him pay. Tough defenseman. And a tough forward in Cook.
Kartner paired up with Thomas Hickey, who was picked up on waivers from the Los Angeles Kings. He's got the puck now, number 14. His days could be numbered, though, because Lubomir Vyshnovsky is expected to rejoin this club. Having played over in the KHL, and originally said he didn't want to come back, but he's coming back. And expected to rejoin the team maybe on Thursday. The puck is dumped in by the Penguins.
And they got 6'8" Joe Finley ready to go as well.
Marty Riesner takes control of the puck. He's the one who took the penalty that cost the Islanders as the Penguins do score on the power play. Sidney Crosby gets the assist on Neal's second power play goal of the year. And the Penguins are 16-0 the last 16 times they've scored the first goal against the Islanders.
And they've scored first 9 of 10 this year. There's Marc-Andre Fleury, Kia starting goaltender. 3-2 on the season. There's his career against the Islanders, and our Hyundai starting goaltender, Evgeny Nabokov, who's 10-2 in his career against Pittsburgh, and that sparkling goals against the save percentage to see on the bottom brings a little bit of stability to the goaltending here, where Rick DiPietro has been unable to do that. First goals have been unbelievable. The only time the Penguins haven't scored first is against the Islanders this year.
Penguins clicking at over 30% on the power play now on the road, Bob. That's their eighth power play goal in 24 opportunities. And they're fourth in the NHL on the road on the power play with those numbers.
They've really been ready to play hockey games. Undeniable. 13-3 in first period scoring this year for the Pittsburgh Penguins. That's a team that's prepared to play. You know, you put the onus on the coaches and the players, and that's a great job in preparing yourself to play the game.
Boy, center one right past the stick of Molson, and taken out by the Pens. James Neal has a little bit of a lane here. He'll cut into the middle and drop it off. And Zach Wojcik wrists one over the goal. Now it's Simon Desprez. He stayed on the ice a long time today at practice. He was out there with the healthy scratches, Eric Tangrady and Dustin Jeffrey. An icing call here against the Penguins. And we thought that maybe Desprez wasn't going to be in the lineup because of that, but he is out there.
Yeah, he's been playing some fantastic spirited hockey. There it is. The first period, 13-3. I mean, man. We know how valuable the first goal is. The Penguins have been doing it. In the second period, they got a little bit better, and it was something of a sore spot for them, but they've been better over the last three hockey games.
Dan Bowser really liked how they responded in Washington in the second period when they had a little adversity there. They buckled down and were able to have a good period of hockey, even though they saw that goal go off the glass behind Thomas Cocoon. Here's Sidney Crosby working deep in the Islander zone, along with Chris Kunitz and Pascal Dupuis. Dupuis to the puck. Sid will take it. Crosby had four shots in the first meeting between these two clubs. Crosby to the goal, the save, and the rebound. Where's the pocket? Didn't go in.
He was swept up by the hand of McDonald right on the goal line. He didn't cover it, apparently. It would have been a penalty shot.
Here's Oposo shooting, and the save made by Fleury. Grabner trying to get to the rebound. Letang broke that up. Grabner gets it again, though. Now to Brian Strait, and he shoots one. Fleury got a stick on it, and it comes off the corner boards and back to center ice. So Sidney Crosby came within an inch of getting his first goal ever against Evgeny Nabokov.
Well, Crosby, he was anticipating Nabokov coming out with a poke check when he came out of the corner from the goal line with the puck. So Crosby shuffled it towards the net. It's just kind of a premonition you have as a great hockey player that Crosby is, and he's found that extra gear.
Cook works the corner. The Penguins have to be very happy with having scored on the power play against an Islander team that's done a really good job killing penalties up to this point. Here's a shot by Paul Martin, and it's right in front of the goalie, Nabokov, and he's able to cover it up.
High shot went off Mark Strait, and they're going to take a look here. They're getting a call from the penalty box right now. I don't know if the league's calling them or not, but here's the play. Sidney Crosby out of the corner, shuffles it to the net. Where's that puck? McDonald sweeping it out.
We're going to have
a battle in the corner, and as he came out, shot the puck towards Nabokov on the backhand, goes off Nabokov's back of his pads, and McDonald reaches away and sweeps it out. The puck has to go all the way over the goal line. It's on edge as it's rolling towards that goal line. McDonald reaches down. Oh, man, that is so, so close. I don't believe it was all the way over the goal line. It couldn't have been any closer.
No.
Great play by McDonald, wasn't it? I guess he had no choice.
They'll drop the puck again to the left of Nabokov. The Islanders come in with 9 points in the standings, a 4-3-1 record. The Penguins are 6-3 with 12 points now, and they are 5-1 on the road.
They're on their heels, the Islanders, right now. And I'll tell you, Biles was said we had it handed to us last game.
There's a shot by Kennedy off the body of Nabokov.
And now they're handing it back.
Cook sends it back down around behind the net. Ryan Strait found a home here on Long Island. Former Penguin defenseman. Now Matt Cook works hard on the end boards. Mark Strait tries it free up the near wall. Actually, Strait is a perfect combination, or complement, I should say, to Strait, because he's a stay-at-home defenseman, and Strait really likes to roam around a bit. So probably the perfect fit.
Good fit. Sometimes a change of scenery. Speaking of change of scenery, Zach Boychuk on the ice right now for the Penguins and looking to get on the board with the big line.
Tyler Kennedy is heading over to the bench. He'll be replaced now by James Neal. And Brooks Orpik. Penguins are now ranked 10th in the NHL defensively, 2.42 goals against. Brooks Orpik happy with that stat. Here's a shot by Boychuk off the glass. Neal back for Boychuk, and he couldn't take the pass, and the Islanders go the other way. Paolo Poso. Simone Dupre trying to get over to meet him, but Poso turns the corner. Letang runs interference on him as Zach Boychuk drags the puck ahead. Finds Evgeny Malkin. Now big Simone Dupre. He is a big boy. He comes into the Islanders zone at the near side and feeds it to the corner. McDonald there. Up the wall, Olsen to McDonald, down to Raposo. Letang tried to clear, and it does come to center ice. Dupre again, nice lead pass to Dupuy. Good stick work though by Travis Kamenik, and he poked it to the near wall. Kunitz trying to get it there. Tavares gets it for the Islanders, and it finds its way back to center ice. Dupuy loses control of the puck, and Matt Molson goes the other way along with Brad Boys. Shoots it, rebound Boys, and he couldn't shoot it. And he got a stick in there to break up the opportunity for Boys for the big rebound off the pads of Fleury. Now straight to straight.
You know, the Penguins don't make a lot of mistakes with the puck, and especially Pasco Dupuy, but they did there. And I'll tell you, turn the other way, staying against the top line. That's a puck management where you have to respect your opponent, play the way you've been playing, not try to make too much happen, get pucks deep like Dupuy did there.
Strait moves it ahead, and Tavares takes over. Pressured a little bit by Joe Vitale. And the Islanders turn the puck over as a result. Brooks Orpik to his partner, Paul Martin. Now Adams. Couldn't get it deep. We'll try again. Bouncing puck. Reisner set it up for a straight. Now to Thomas Hickey. Again, Vitale all over him. And they force another turnover and dump the puck in. Great work by the Penguins' fourth line.
Yeah, they don't have to score to be effective, do they? They just want to play in the offensive zone, bank some bodies, rag some time.
Matt Martin back to the puck for Cizikas, a shot. He scored a goal last week in Pittsburgh. Now Hickey wristed one to the net. Cleared aside by Vitale to Craig Adams. He'll gain the red line and make sure he gets it deep. And Tanner Glass will go in and play it. Malkin's on the ice now. Glass and Adams remain on here. Malkin trying to get control of the puck. Casey Cizikas has it. Now Adams and Tanner Glass go to the bench. And Boychuk and Neal are on, joining Malkin as Engelin lifts it inside the line. Neal will feed it to the corner. Hickey back to play it. Moves it to the side of the net. Kartner reversed it to the corner, but right onto the stick of Evgeny Malkin. Hickey leans on Gino, but Gino finds Boychuk. Out to the point on Letang. Across ice, Dupre lost control for a moment. Now just wrists it in deep. It came off the boards to the side of the net goal, and then the Islanders trying to get it out. Look at James Neal backing up Dupre. Shoots the puck and missed the net. And it goes up into the netting. That was good work by Neal, getting in position to help out Dupre, who had pinched down the wall. We'll be back in a moment.
The Penguins lead at 1-0 on a goal by that man.
Miller time.
Well, the Rivers Casino tips to win here tonight. Respect your opponent, the New York Islanders. They've been going strong. They're getting better. And they've won three straight against the Pens. Special teams, yes, 1-0 on that department for Pittsburgh on the Neil power play goal. And crowd of Evgeny Nabokov, who is 10-2 in his career against Pittsburgh Penguins. Malkin, Crosby, neither have scored against Nabokov. Crosby was that close, though. Nabokov, it was saved by his defenseman's hand reaching in there, McDonald.
Look at that threesome right there. That's a lot of goals in your picture right there. Sidney Crosby, Evgeny Malkin, and James Neal. And now Tanner Glass and company had a good shift a moment ago.
And you see our tough predicament. Every game we start with our lines. And, you know, we got Crosby. Is he the greatest player in the game? We got Malkin. Is he the greatest player in the game? Which line do you put first? It's a tough problem to have, Staggy, but that's, you know, it's something we talk about coming into every game.
It's 1-1A in Pittsburgh. It's not the first line and the second line. Here's Chris Letang. Turned it over, though. Shot by Nielsen, and he fired it up over the goal and off the glass. And he's still looking for his first goal, as I said. He's not going to score by missing the net by that margin. Now Hamonic with it at the right corner. Wrist shot. Fleury steered it to the corner. Michael Grabner. Grabner. Letang chasing him all the way up to the blue line. Punched back to the corner by McDonald. Dupree is there. Bouncing puck. Dupree leaning on Paolo Pusso. And now Grabner joins to try to get control. He's on the wall. Look at this battle along the boards for the puck. And they finally win the battle. McDonald. Hamonic, a shot. Fleury the save. The rebound gathered in by Tyler Kennedy. And the Islanders want to change as Kennedy comes racing out of his own zone. The Islanders come off the bench to greet him. He's surrounded by blue jerseys and shoots the puck off the skate of McDonald. Gets in on the puck and feeds it in behind the net for Matt Cook. Crosby's on the ice right now. Cook tried to get it to him, but John Tavares has it. Cook stripped him of the puck, and Matt Molson drops it off.
The last sequence, I love Simone Dupree's passion in his own zone, and Brandon Sutter is so good defensively. Puck comes to the front of the net, big fat rebound. Oposo's there, so is Brandon Sutter. What a job.
Brad Boyce to Molson, a shot, and good stick work with the Penguins in front of the net to prevent that shot from getting through. And now Kunitz lost control. Brad Boyce goes the other way. The pass attended for Molson eventually gets to him. Now he finds Tavares, and these guys are dangerous. And Tavares to the point. Strike with a wrister in traffic. Molson just kind of threw it out of the pack to the near wall where it's taken by Tavares. And finally, the Penguins able to force it back to neutral ice. Paul Martin takes control. That's a good shift for the top line of the Islanders.
But it was fed, wasn't it, by a bad pass in the neutral zone by the Penguins. It was a bad transition through the neutral zone, and it turned the other way against that top line.
Catch some local college hoops. Robert Morris against St. Francis. Don't miss the tip-off between the Colonials and the Red Flash. Live tomorrow at 7 on Root Sports. We have a brand new studio now at Root Sports. Can't wait to see it, Bob.
Yeah. You guys will be looking good back there in the intermission. Everybody will see it.
Now the puck fired down the ice, and McDonald back to touch it, and an icing call against Pittsburgh. Well, Jack Capuano, Bob, he knows what it's like to get hit on the bench with a puck now. And that happened the other day in a game against New Jersey.
Well, he's already lost weight. He's lucky he wasn't eaten through a straw or something. He's lucky he didn't break his jaw. But there you see the after effects.
He took 5 stitches, and there were 3 tears in his pupil. Could have been a lot worse. Tony Granato almost got struck in the head the other day in Washington, and he was talking about it last night. He was laughing about it, but he was laughing about it when it happened too. But he said, "I came this close from really getting it."
I know it's not funny. You're not always paying attention to the puck. You're talking to your players, you're coaching, telling them what they did or didn't do in the previous shift, and you're not always focusing on that puck.
Boychuk catches up with the puck. Zach Boychuk has Malkin behind him, goes back instead to Bortuzzo, a shot, and he fired it off the goalpost. It was a good choice by Boychuk as he went back to the late man, Bortuzzo, who almost scored his second goal in the NHL.
Boy, the Islanders had to make a quick change. Hamonic got pounded on the wall. He had to go to the bench, and they were late getting out of defenseman. Bortuzzo's been joining the rush, and yeah, as you mentioned, he's been getting up on plays.
And Bobby, I like the fact that Boychuk went to him because it's not like he's over-deferring, if you will, to Evgeny Malkin. And most guys, getting that opportunity, would be looking for him and try to force feed him the puck. And he made a nice play there to work it back to Bortuzzo, who almost scored.
Remember in his first game, there was a two-on-one, and he was forced to take the shot, and Boychuk did. And Malkin said, when he came back to the bench, he said, good decision, good decision. That's what you want from guys like Malkin. You want that leadership. It makes him feel like he doesn't have to force the puck, just as you say.
Now it's Thomas Hickey with it.
But another player, you know, if a guy wanted the puck all the time and he took a different approach, he said, I want that puck, or give me the puck. Well, he may not have made that wise choice there.
Very. Matt Kartner shoots it wide of the net over to the near side. It's taken there by Adams as he goes across now to Simon Dupre. I know Dan Bioff has sat down with over a half an hour with Zach Boychuk to tell him about the idiosyncrasies of one of Evgeny Malkin and also James Neal. And he said, hey, there's going to be times when he's going to be barking at you in Russian, and don't take it personally. He said he and Neal do that a lot as it is.
Yep,
they yell
they
at one another. Yeah.
Oh, they do, Malkin. Oh, yeah, we saw that last year with James Neal. He wasn't always happy, but that's okay. I remember Kevin Stevens barking down at us on the bench, and it was worth a couple of cups. Look at that wrist shot by Bertuzzo.
On sale now. PittsburghPenguins.com.
I didn't know you owned a furniture store, Bob.
Sure would. Well, Craig Adams, an interference play on Nielsen. Nielsen got caught up in the bench, so the hot, well, I don't know if they're hot power play, but they can certainly toss it around. They were 0 for 7 in their last outing against the Devils. They moved from number 1 to number 3, the New York Islanders power play. But Molson right there, you're looking at him, a former ninth round pick of the Pittsburgh Penguins back in 2003.
14 power play goals last year, only 4 fewer than James Neal.
I got a quick stat for you. Ninth round, straight. Ninth round, 2004. Nabokov, ninth round, 1994. And Molson, ninth round, 2003. Three, you could arguably say, next to Tavares, the three best players on this honor club, all ninth round draft picks, Deggy. You like it?
I do like it. Here's Brad Boyce, former first round pick. Throws it in front off the stick of Tavares and just wide of the goal. Paul Martin trying to work it out. Sutter couldn't get a stick on it to get it out, and Nielsen's got it now. Boyce works it in behind the net. Molson's there. Tavares holds it. These guys are dangerous. Strike can't keep it in, and he'll have to retreat to center ice. Franz Nielsen looks to distribute the puck. Finds Strike. A shot deflected. Save made by Fleury. Another chance. Great save again by Fleury on Tavares, and the Penguins clear.
And what a rebound, and what a play by Tanner Glass. Sucked down into the slot, lifted the stick of Molson, who was going to deposit it on the back end behind the fallen Fleury. Great play by Tanner Glass on the penalty kill. After a big save by Fleury on Tavares.
He got a lot of wood on that shot because you could hear a thump off the equipment of Fleury all the way up here. 43 seconds on the penalty, and McDonald can't keep it in. The fans booing the Islanders, and they just got a great scoring opportunity. And yeah, the fans that are here, there's a lot of empty seats here on Long Island, and you wonder what the effect is of the Islanders moving to Brooklyn on the psyche of the fans. I mean, the Islanders are off to a good start this year, and they are playing the Penguins and the two best players in the world, perhaps. You'd think that would be enough to get people to come out, but it's a kind of a disappointing crowd here tonight on Long Island.
It is. I mean, how about that play? Molson did it in Pittsburgh. Molson to Tavares. It was in the net. This time, Molson to Tavares. Fleury read it, got across, made that huge save. But I'll tell you, that telepathy, that communication between two guys that played lacrosse together and hockey when they were kids in Mississauga, Ontario, Molson and Tavares, it's unbelievable what they have. I mean, they're not twins or anything like the Sedins, but you feel like they are.
What's that stat on Tavares? And here's Nielsen shooting, and he fired it wide. You can give that number when you get a chance, Bob. It's Bortuzzo on the bread and butter of those two.
Tavares has been on the ice for the last 64 Molson goals. He's been on the ice for the last 64 Matt Molson goals.
That's bread and butter. Here's Cizikas with it now. Casey Cizikas left it in the corner. Now they find Ryan Strait. kind of dusts the puck off a bit and falls down, works it behind the net. Penalty coming up here. And the Islanders are going to go right back to a power play. And whoa. Neil just knocked an Islander down over there. That was Colin McDonald. He's the one who hit Ben Lovejoy from behind last week.
Yes, he got a two-game suspension. This is his first game back. We're 2 years removed from one of the most ugly games I've ever seen in the history of hockey. Back in 2011, February 11th.
And here's a little bit of mucking right there.
Oh, that's what happened. I wasn't
good hit,
sure how he got decked.
Just got thrown down by the left paw. Here's the Islanders' chance. There's a deflection. Here's the pass from Molson to Tavares. Big save by Fleury. But look at the stick of glass. Lift Molson's stick as he was going to put that rebound in the net. That was a beautiful play by Tanner Glass. Look at that. That is really tremendous work. And to clear the puck in the same motion, strength.
And Desprez is the man in the box for tripping. The Islanders had two shots, and you saw just saw one of them on their power play. They're going to get another chance here. I didn't really think of Colin McDonald as a physical guy, Bob, when he played for the Penguins for a brief stint last year, but now we've seen him crush a Lovejoy from behind, and he took the body pretty hard there on Sidney Crosby. Now here's Nielsen with it. He goes to the right wing. Boys drops it off the strike. Wright shoots it, and it's blocked nicely by Brandon Sutter. His dad, Brent Sutter, played here for a long time. He's a star for those championship Islander teams. Now the puck is cleared off the near wall by Brandon Sutter, and the Islanders will regroup. A minute 56 remaining in the period. A minute 15 to go on the penalty to Simone Desprez, who took two penalties on Sunday in Washington. Here's Brad Boys with it now. Boys cruising in. Shoots it, and Fleury made the save. Boys again try to set it up. And it comes right to Matt Molson. Back for Boys in the corner. Tavares is posted up on the right side of the ice. Straight with a shot up high. Tavares gets to the puck, trying to quickly center to Nielsen. And Nielsen centers for Molson. Molson shoots it. Fleury stands up and makes the save. And they punch in the rebound, but it's after the whistle blew.
Oh, yeah, and a little bit of tension being paid to Molson, who put that puck into the net after the whistle. That attention being paid by Brooks Orpik. A good healthy dislike for one another on the ice. The Penguins couldn't kindle any of this up at all in Pittsburgh. They just couldn't get this kind of emotion. Now they got the emotion in their game. But the Islanders got 10 shots by virtue of some of these power plays. 10 shots to 4 right now. The Penguins are still up.
Coming up in the first intermission presented by your neighborhood Ford store with Rob King and Jay Caulfield, Dan Potash and James Neal. Jay's telestration and highlights and analysis during the intermission. Sidney Crosby, who has taken the second most faceoffs in the NHL this year, taking the draw here against Oposo, and the Islanders win the faceoff. 45 seconds to go on this power play. Penguins leading 1-0. Islanders would love to get a goal before the buzzer here. Keith O'Coin on the ice in the second power play unit. McDonald goes to the right side, and Hamonic right back to Andy McDonald. Now for Oposo. O'Coin walks in front. It goes off a stick. Fleury's body down. Puck is loose. Still loose. Oposo reaching in for it. Fleury finds the puck and covers it up.
A little bit slower whistle this time. Sidney Crosby went back door and lifted a stick to help out after not getting a faceoff win. He talked about Crosby's second most faceoffs. Watch his puck get underneath Fleury. Crosby with a stick between the legs of Grabner. Everybody trying to protect things. And finally, Marc-Andre Fleury's able to reach out with his palm on his stomach. He frees that puck.
O'Coin wanted to score there. He walked in front of Letang, got a stick in at the last second. And now Nielsen with it. Sets it up for strike. 53 seconds to go in the period. 13 seconds remaining on this power play. Boys goes cross ice. Tavares face finds strike. Strike shot. Blocked beautifully by Brandon Sutter. And Matt Cook and Brandon Sutter take off. Nielsen's getting back on the play. Sutter shorthanded. Shoots it wide. Penalty's over now. And the net is dislodged as Cook went right to the goal.
And he got taken down as well as he's going to the net. He's saying, did I fall on my own? And he's not very happy that there wasn't a call made. As it was a two-on-two coming the other way. Sutter and Cook got in the lane, blocked the shot. Sutter's looking.
Nielsen tied up Cook. His legs just kind of went out from under him, and they tried to buy that call a bit, but Nielsen definitely was hooking him up as he went through the goal.
Molson, he's feeling a little discomfort on the bench, as you see.
Penguins killed two Islander power plays here in the first period. That's big after they had scored a couple in Pittsburgh last week and were one of the top power plays in the NHL. Here's Evgeny Malkin. Now to Neal, a shot, and Nabokov to save. Malkin to the rebound. Centers! Oh, went off a stick and right to the equipment of Nabokov. Kunitz was in there looking for the rebound. Now Matt Martin puts him in a little bit of a headlock. And it... Faceoff coming up to the left of the Islander goal with 18.3 seconds to go.
And those are the first two shots on net for Pittsburgh in the last 13:45 of this period. It was nine straight by the Islanders. Of course, they had two power plays, another shot by Neal, and then one comes off a skate right to Nabokov and freezes it. Big faceoff here with 18.3 left in the first period of play. And certainly a spirited period by both clubs.
Well, the Islanders have beaten the Penguins three straight times. They're not taking them lightly by any means. And the Islanders
look out, look out, look out.
Here we go, Matt Martin. Glass. And Tanner Glass. Whoa. Rights and lefts. Glass with a couple of lefts. There's a left that got on the button. Now the jersey pulled up over Tanner Glass's head and a right hand from Matt Martin. He sneaks another one in there. And that'll be the end of that.
Now, Tanner Glass had a conversation with McDonald on the faceoff circle for that hit McDonald laid not just on Lovejoy, but on Sidney Crosby in this period. And Tanner Glass went out. There he is. He's having a little conversation with 13 McDonald. And Martin jumps in. Matt Martin jumps in the aid. McDonald.
So Tanner Glass wanted McDonald after what he had done to Ben Lovejoy, but Matt Martin says, no, you're fighting me. You're not fighting him. And pretty good bout again with Tanner Glass. His fights aren't boring, are they?
Oh, he's a tough man. His first one was 54 seconds in New York against Aaron Asham. This one here, a good scrap. Oh, and just hope he had his tie down there. I didn't look to see, but you have to have your tie down. I don't know how his jersey went over there, and if it was, I'm sure it was. Most of the players do. We've seen in the past some players not. Letang get thrown out of a game a couple of years ago for not having his jersey tied down.
Penguins win the draw. They could get something going here. They have a little bit of time. Here's Neal trying to knock the puck down. Out of the corner, Hamonic sends it around. Evgeny Malkin with it. 5 seconds to go. What's this? Another penalty coming up?
James Neal with the...
The Hamonic.
Look on his face. And Bertuzzo and Hamonic. Hamonic got hit earlier in the hockey game. And I don't know if it was a cross check on Neal or not, but the Penguins are going to not only for 5 seconds be short, but to start the second period if the Islanders don't score. It's going to be a cross check on Neal as Hamonic goes back for the puck. You're just a push.
He pushed him.
I'm not sure what the 2 minutes was for. Pushing for roughing.
Well,
the defenseman was in a vulnerable position, a couple of feet from the boards. They don't want to see anybody push with the extension of the arms into the boards.
I like the Penguins showing emotion. They've got to be careful, though, to not let that discipline problem creep back in here, as they've now taken three consecutive penalties in a 1-0 game to the New York Islanders with that dangerous power play that they have. So they'll deal with that at the start of the second period. And we will toss right now to Rob King and Jay Caulfield in our brand new, spanking beautiful new studio.
Whee!
At Root Sports.
All right, Staggy and Bob, thanks very much. With Jay Caulfield and Jay, early on in that period, the Penguins looked like they picked right where they left off their last three games. The tide began to turn, and then it got really feisty towards the end of that first period.
Yeah, I certainly like the intensity. What they had going, I like that. And then when the Islanders got their power play opportunity, started to turn the momentum. But you talked about the feistiness. I like the way they protected the goaltender. I like the way Tanner Glass stood up for Crosby or any other teammate. When you start doing that, you know you're a team that's coming together, and they played hard. Islanders, look, good talented team, played the game fast, good first period.
All right, we have a lot coming your way in our first intermission report brought to you by your neighborhood Ford store. Dan Potash will have a player interview. Jay will bust out his brand new Telestrator and highlights from around the NHL when we return here on Root Sports.
Physical, gritty hockey, right to our game, right off the hop. We are going with 44, 58, 14, 9, 87. And Flower, you're in the cage here, gentlemen. Let's go, let's go.
Crosby stops. He scores!
Now, Penguins Intermission, presented by your neighborhood Ford store.
Penguins looking for their fourth consecutive victory. James Neal with a power play goal, staking them to a 1-0 lead after one period of play. As we welcome you back to our first intermission report presented by your neighborhood Ford store. James Neal did something that few teams have been able to do against the New York Islanders. That is score a power play goal. Just the third shorthanded goal the Islanders have given up this year. He is with Dan Potash, brought to you by UPMC Sports Medicine.
Well, James, considering how things went against the Islanders just a few days ago back at home, how important was it to come out, score first, and kind of set the tempo in this one?
Well, we just wanted to be better overall. It was a tough one in our own building against the Islanders last time, and wanted to come out and be physical and, get a lucky bounce and got a good shot off.
Being physical and emotions are part of this game, but obviously you have to have that limited to some extent. How do you adjust, if you will, for the second and third period, considering how the first period went?
Well, I'll just be smart. I think we did a good job. A few penalties we could have back, like mine there at the end, but we'll kill that off and come back strong.
James, thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Potash.
Gentlemen.
Dan and James, thanks very much. And Jay, when you take a look at that power play goal, the Penguins picking right up where they left off. Again, they had that really bad game, probably their worst game of the year against the Islanders. Since then, they'd won three in a row, outscored those three opponents 14-4. They have the 1-0 lead now, and that power play goal, very big, because the Islanders really came on at the end of that first period.
Yeah, again, when you look at the speed of the game, I just think even this game, there's intensity right off the start, from the beginning, from the drop of the puck, Pittsburgh's going hard. Then you get that early goal, which is big, because I thought Nabokov, it looks like he's kind of scrambling around a little bit. If Pittsburgh starts to get, they kill this penalty off, get pressure going, get it right back at him. But you like the intensity. I like the speed. When they're fast, they're tough to play against. That's what Pittsburgh wants to do.
Well, Jay mentioned the word big, and speaking of big, wait till you see Jay's new Telestrator. That's going to be up next. It's going to make its debut when we continue on here with our first intermission report, brought to you by your neighborhood Ford store, with the Pens leading the Islanders 1-0 through one.
Visit Jeep.com to learn more.
And welcome back to our first intermission report presented by your neighborhood Ford store. The Penguins leading the Islanders 1-0 through one period of play. And welcome back to our brand new Root Sports studio and Jay's new Telestrator, a new item for Jay to telestrate for you and show you some good plays. And Jay, really turnovers were affecting the Penguins when they weren't playing well earlier in the season. And sometimes you have to adjust and maybe make a smarter, different play to avoid turnovers.
Well, some of the things we talk and we like is when you can go D to D. So when they go D to D in this position, you're going to see Brooks Orpik. We just want him. He's going to move the puck this way. And you can see we're just picking up. We got Malkin here. We've got Neal. And you've got Boychuk. And you're going to watch how they can swing. That's what you want to see. So once you go D to D, we're going to watch. We're going to go from Orpik to Martin. Look how you're getting the speed with Malkin and Neal. The one thing, freeze it right here. You think in this spot, Neal's going to be the target for a direct pass from Martin. But what we don't pick up is, or we can just catch him right here. There's Nielsen right here who's taken away, is going to take away Neal. So let's watch what Martin does. There's Neal right there. He goes off the boards. We talk about freeze it right there. Off the boards, you find Malkin, and again, it's so much better sometimes. You don't have a direct pass, so when you go off the boards, he finds Malkin, and next thing we're going to see is you're going to have Neal drive and open up a lane. Here comes Malkin. He spins out, and again, once Neal takes everybody, freeze it right there. Neal takes everybody. It opens up a lane, and he finds Boychuk. Again, the key, I believe, once Neal drives right there, it gives him, look, everybody focusing at Malkin, and he finds Boychuk, which is an opportunity. And when Pittsburgh starts doing that, you get a chance off of this. So again, sometimes you don't have that direct pass. Use the boards, and Neal drives, and it creates opportunities.
Unfortunately for the Penguins, Jay, after that telestration, not a lot of opportunities for the Penguins. They got some early on. Let's take a look at our four-pick capital by the numbers. And I think what really jumps out for you, the shots on goal after the Penguins, really, Jay, had been kind of dominating early on.
Yeah, those shots, again, the power play started to turn the momentum. Obviously, they're on one now, ending the period and starting the second, but that gave momentum to the Islanders. But Pittsburgh, again, still their tenacity, their drive, they're sticking up for each other. I like that. And once they kill this penalty off, get that momentum back.
All right, we have highlights from around the league when we return with the first intermission report brought to you by your neighborhood Ford store. Sports, On Long Island, the Penguins leading the Islanders by a score of 1-0 through 1. The Penguins have a penalty kill that they have to face here at the beginning of the second period. Meanwhile, this used to be a one-sided rivalry with the Penguins dominating the Islanders, but it has become a very intense rivalry. Very quickly, we saw that with some feisty and physical play, particularly towards the end of the first period. For more, let's take you back to the guys who are going to call the second period for you, Steige and Bob, on Long Island. Guys?
All right, thank you, Rob. Yeah, it was physical, Bob, and it's all about how you handle that physicality, and Penguins taking some penalties in the process, too.
Yeah, you have to control your emotion. You can't let it get you out of your game, and for the Penguins, they were physical. But when it was 1-0, after they got a little bit physical, they crossed the line, I thought. They didn't get a shot for over 13 minutes, and they found themselves in the box twice, now three times. They have to start the third period killing a penalty. But you know, you want to stand up for yourself. You want to stand up for your teammates. You just have to know where that line is. The Penguins were not happy. They had it handed to them by the Islanders. They want to win this game in more ways than one.
Tonight's face-offs are presented by the new face of Northwood Realty Services. And we open the second period with a face-off between Craig Adams and John Tavares. Of course, Adams, the penalty killer par excellence of the Penguins, along with Brooks Orpik, Paul Martin, and Pascal Dupuis. And Tavares pulls the puck back, and it'll be taken by Franz Nielsen. He works it ahead to Brad Boyes, who goes all the way back to Mark Streit, and the Islanders will start it up from their own zone with a lot of time to work with, a man advantage, trailing 1-0. A minute 42 to go on the penalty to James Neal. Paul Martin back to the puck. Has to eat it for a moment, and he was under pressure from two Islanders. Tavares finds Boyes, who goes to Streit. Streit to Boyes, a one-timer. He fanned on it. Didn't break his stick. Loose puck, flurry down. Penguins clear the puck, but it's taken by Brad Boyes. Boyes hanging on to it. Back out to Streit. Tavares posts up way over here on the near side, on the right side on the power play. And there they try to get it through to him, but Adams read that, and he picks off the pass intended for Tavares from Brad Boyes, and the Penguins able to clear it.
Oh, I love that. Adams had a stick in one position, like he was going to shut down Nielsen in the slot, and then he turned it at the last second. Sometimes you have to be sneaky that way defensively. Try to disguise your stick positions. Always keep your stick in different, move it left, move it right. Keeps the passer kind of up in arms. What am I going to do? Which direction do I want to go? And that was a great play by Adams.
And I talked to Adams about that very thing today, about how Tavares has been posting up way across the ice on that right side for the one-timers. He said he just kind of moves up and back to try to find that place where the seam could be open for a pass. So he just basically baited Boyes into throwing that puck right into that, what he thought was a seam. Now here's Grabner. Look at that speed. And a goal. And the save made by Fleury, and he covers up. Well, he go grab and turn on the Jets.
And where does he find him? Well, he goes back deep. He comes with speed. So when he gets the puck, he's already in motion. And he's going to get a lot of chances. He's not always going to score. It's a tough battle one-on-one, but look at his speed. And there's a lot of open ice there. A lot of width for the Penguins defense in Englund and Letang. And Grabner just went right through that wide open.
22 seconds to go on the penalty. The Islanders win an important faceoff. Hamonic with it now to Tavares. Boyes is in the slot. Hamonic shot, and it's deflected away, and Nielsen will get to it. Dumps it off the glass nicely to Tavares. Out now to Hamonic. Off the bench comes McDonald. Slap pass for Boyes, who directed it wide of the net. Now Tavares racing after the puck along with Paul Martin. Adams got there. Crosby over to take it. Penalty's over. Neal's on the ice. And he tries to get to the puck, but John Tavares has it. And now a penalty coming up here, as Neal was hit on the near side. An interference call. Who's it going against? Hamonic.
Sidney Crosby out there at the end of the penalty kill, taking advantage of what he's hoping is a tired New York Islander defense. And be able to gain a penalty in the offensive zone, either Neal or Hamonic. Right there, a late hit, they say, on James Neal. As the puck goes by, there's the contact.
So a face-off to the right of Nabokov. Hamonic shaking his head as the Penguins go to work with a man advantage now. Leading 1-0. Some excellent penalty killing by the Penguins. Three straight kills, but now they have a chance to take a two-goal lead on the power play. Here's Letang to Crosby. Crosby passed it for Malkin out of his reach, and he finds Letang. His shot through traffic, deflected wide of the goal. Kunis was right in front of the net. As usual, here's Letang with it. Malkin, one-timer, saved the Bakov. Kunis puts in a rebound at game three. Marty Reisner able to lift it up off the glass. Look at that stick by Crosby to keep it in. Over to Malkin. Malkin lost control of it. Now Reisner pokes it to Neal and now to Kunitz, who helps it around for Crosby. Sidney Crosby to the corner for Kunitz. Ryan Strait bumps him. Sid's got the puck, moves it out to Letang, takes the shot, finds Neal. Right back to Chris Letang. Malkin's open. Letang goes that way. Crosby in the slot. Pass for his stick. Oh, and he took a stick in the face.
Yep. I don't know if it was a stick or the puck. I didn't get a good look at it. As the Penguins were passing that puck around, it came in to the center of that box. And the referee, no referee, I don't think, put their hand up. I don't know if it was a stick or a puck that went up into the face of Sidney Crosby. Went down right away. There's a lot of blood on the ice. Boy, and I don't know why anybody would want to clap at that.
Well, you know.
Dangerous. It looked like it right up underneath that visor. There's Crosby in the middle. Off a stick of 37. Straight and right up into the face of Sidney Crosby. There's a stick down. Puck straight up into Sidney Crosby's face. Goes to the dressing room, and the Penguins still have a minute 10 left on this power play. Boy, and prior to that, there was such, how about that thievery by Crosby out at the blue line with a stick to reach in and to steal the puck out. I mean, he didn't ruffle anybody's feathers either. He just went in and went out. So slick-like. Like the Scrooge almost.
Here's Letang to Malkin. Tyler Kennedy joins the power play now for the Penguins, along with Kunitz and Neal and Malkin. Gino to TK and now to Kunitz. Closing in. Goes to Letang. A shot on the block. I've read that beautifully. It made the save look easy. Letang to Kunitz. Right back to Chris Letang. Letang down to the goal line. Kennedy threw it right through the goal mouth. Kunitz took a spill into the end boards as the Islanders come back shorthanded. 42 seconds to go. Grabner's shot. He fanned on it. Malkin got a stick in there. Neal ahead. Now to Kennedy. He's got some room down that right side. He sends it around to the near side for Kunitz. Kunitz holds it. Works it down low for Tyler Kennedy. 29 seconds to go on the penalty. Nielsen up top on the penalty kill. Pressure in the tank. Malkin one-timer from a sharp angle off the corner boards. And it ricochets all the way back into Penguin ice.
Well, Malkin, it would have been fitting. He made the defensive play stick on puck against Grabner. He had put that one-timer in.
Here's Kennedy again. Wants to shoot it. Instead goes back to Letang. Kunitz in front of the net. 7 seconds on this Penguin power play. Kennedy doesn't shoot it. Now makes a nice pass to Kunitz to the side of the goal. Out to Malkin. Malkin centered and didn't shoot it either. And Hamonic out of the box. Kennedy's got the puck. Islanders back at full strength. Malkin turns the corner. Paul Martin with a puck. Martin to Letang. It looks like the power play continues here. But now Nabokov will freeze it. And we look at our barrel Subaru leaders. Penguins are up there in the road win department, aren't they, Bob?
Well, since 09-10, only one ahead of the Boston Bruins. And this year, they're 5-1. The Islanders are 3-1-1 on the road for Pittsburgh. 7-10, 8-12 to start on the road. I mean, what a way to get going. It was an extended shift by Malkin there. It was out for well over 2 minutes.
Dupuy turns and shoots it. It's off a stick and up over the goal. And McDonald over to the puck. Out for David Ullstrom. He couldn't get a piece of it, but it comes back to the Penguin line. Orpik sent it the other way, and Sutter picks it up. He's got Boychuk and Dupuy with him. This is the line after the Penguins' power play, and the puck froze it at the side of the goal by Nabokov.
Let's take a look at our AGH scratches in this hockey game tonight against the New York Islanders. Dustin Jeffrey, Tangrady, and Ben Lovejoy all raring to goal. Sidney Crosby just went down the runway after being struck by a puck. Redirected puck into his face. As soon as we have any information, we'll relay that to you.
Brooks Orpik to the puck, sends it back in behind the net for Dupuy. Thomas Hickey got in there to get a stick on it. And now it's Boychuk, Zach Boychuk. To Paul Martin, back to the corner. McDonald there, Dupuy trying to get it free. And the Islanders finally are going to get that puck out to center. Brooks Orpik paired up with Paul Martin. Sutter, Dupuy, and Boychuk on the ice. Boychuk and Sutter, good friends from their days in Carolina. Now line mates for the moment. Dupuy back to the corner. Brandon Sutter tried to center one to Dupuis, broken up, and Michael Grabner ahead to Boyes. He finds Tavares on the right wing. John Tavares, very slick, throws it right to the front of the net. Grabner and Boyes both there, loose puck, and now the shot taken, and that's blocked. And Tavares got to the loose puck, and there were a couple opportunities for shots there, and the Islanders just couldn't find the trigger.
Yeah, Tavares, Boyes, and Grabner now. We showed you earlier Molson was in discomfort on the bench. I don't know if they split those two up or not. We'll see if Molson's okay.
And Oposo got a stick on it, but it comes right to Simone Desprez, and he works it up the left wing to Matt Cook. Cook will dump it up into the Islanders' zone. Brian straight back to get it. Adams gets there first. Now David Ahlstrom, who's noted for his good speed, is down on his knees as the puck comes back to Robert Bortuzzo. Ahead now to Joe Vitale. Nice little bank pass to Matt Cook. Cook forces it up to the corner. Straight goes back to play it. Cook punishes him. Straight goes down, but Franz Nielsen there to get it. Back around for Mark Streit. Up off the glass. Between the legs of Engelin. Robert Bortuzzo. Pass too hard for Kunitz. No icing on the play. McDonald back to get it. Here comes Kunitz. He takes a piece of him. The Islanders, Keith O'Coin, longtime minor leaguer, goes to the left wing to another one, Colin McDonald. Back in behind the net for Casey Cizikas. He centers, and it goes past everybody and out the center.
Cizikas hit Bortuzzo, got to the front of the net. Pass wasn't on its mark.
McDonald, physical against Engelin. And the Islanders win possession of the puck. Casey Cizikas out to Hamannik, a shot. That missed the net. Bortuzzo able to get it. And Cizikas got there first. Hamannik to McDonald, a shot. Again, wide of the goal. The Islanders maintaining possession of the puck here, but a good read that time by Neal. Didn't get the puck out, however. McDonald takes it again. McDonald, O'Coin, Hamannik, McDonald, Cizikas. Now Boyes steps on.
Too many men on the ice. Looked like it just for a second. The Islanders made a quick change. The man got out to confront Malkin.
Now the puck shot up into the seats of the near side, and that brings a whistle. So the special teams, neither power play can connect, and the Penguins continue to nurse a 1-0 lead here on the island.
Crosby's back on the bench, only missed 4 minutes and 43 seconds of game time. And this isn't new for Sidney Crosby. March 29th, 2012, Dylan Reese clearing a puck, hit Crosby. And, of course, tonight, there's a redirect by the stick of Straight into the nose of Sidney Crosby.
And I think it was the same result. I remember him coming out in that game with gauze in his nose, Bob, and it was more of a nose issue than I was concerned at first. It might be up near his eye when he was holding that towel up. But he took it right on the nose. And he was smiling on the bench as they were talking to him when he came out, so he's all right. The Islanders offside here. Penguins are leading on a power play goal by James Neal. So the Penguins do have one power play goal. And after failing on that last power play, key is though they killed 3 Islander power plays in succession.
And they had Crosby for half of the last power play. He was on the power play when he suffered the shot in the nose. But there's been some good shifts since then for the Islanders, especially their third line.
Bray able to get the puck to center, took a bump from Brad Boyes after doing so, and now he bodies up on Boyes and allows Dupuis. Are they going to call a penalty here?
Yeah, interference call. You know, they've called at least three interference calls in this hockey game.
I agree with that call at all.
They've been very consistent, whether you agree or not. They've called interference.
And that's not right. I know what they're trying to do. They're trying to prevent defensemen from changing their path to interfere on a player after he's dumped the puck in. But that was too close quarters for that call, I think, to be made. It's different if you're coming in on a full rush and you dump it in behind a guy and he
in defense of a linesman, I would have rather not seen Desprez put his hand up on the player instead of just get his body kind of in position.
Well, that's a good point, too. You can't ever use a free hand. It is interference, and Tavares with a shot. And Fleury makes the save, and Cook clears the rebound.
We've seen Hamonic interference, you know, we've got the Niels interference and DeBray interference, and
yeah,
whether it's boarding, whatever the flavor of the week kind of seems to be, the referees have, will keep going, they'll keep calling it.
Now Tavares with it, and Paul Martin just reaches in and takes it away from him, sends it around for Brooks Orpik. Orpik finds Brandon Sutter, and that is some methodical work there to break the puck out of the defensive zone on the penalty kick.
Great call, Staggy, because none of the players were facing to get the puck down. They're all on their backhand, so they use one another. Use the wall, use one another. They spread out. They took two or three passes, but they did get it down.
Brad Boyes takes the right wing pass. Oposo holds up at the line to stay onside, and Brooks Orpik to the puck. But the Islanders have it, and strike goes cross ice. Molson, wrist shot, blocked in front, and it's going to be cleared. And the Penguins protecting the house. Oposo. Around Orpik. Martin there again. Turns his back to Oposo. Ends up with a puck. Up the wall it goes to McDonald. Now to strike. 1-0 Penguins. 37 seconds to go on the penalty to DePray. Oposo tries to wrap one in, and Fleury makes the save, reaching for the rebound, but Tanner Glass gets there, and he skates it out and then pushes it the rest of the way.
Grabner goes off, reaching down to his lower body after a rebound right in front of Marc-Andre Fleury. I think he took a shot.
Hamonic dumps the puck in. Fleury tried to clear it. And it goes into the netting. And
did go off the glass.
The whistle blows. You go inside the game and inside the lives of your Penguin players during the new series Inside Penguins Hockey, presented by Heritage Valley Health System. This week, Sidney Crosby recalls a near scuffle with Ty Domi. Inside Penguins Hockey Saturday after Penn's postgame on Root Sports. What's up with Grabner?
Well, he got whacked by a Penguin forward on the last penalty kill. I believe it was Tanner Glass, and he's feeling the brunt of that right now. You go to the front of the net, there's a price to pay, and he paid it, and the Penguins have killed this penalty.
Hamonic got his feet pulled right out from under him by Chris Kunitz.
Was it a snoofler? A trip?
And the Penguins are going to go right back on a penalty kill again. They're flirting with danger now as Casey Cizikas takes it. And there's Matt Martin shoots it. Fleury was down and he shot it off the glove of Fleury. He might have got a piece of that and went up into the netting behind the goal.
Man, I think he did doing cartwheels. I think Marc-Andre Fleury got some webbing on that. Oh, yeah. What a save by Marc-Andre Fleury.
The Islanders, they have 9 shots in their previous 4, and here's Kunitz. He went back and kind of
just
slew-footed.
It was just
a trip where he used his leg to trip him, though.
So kicking motion there, so
exactly,
it's not
a
slew-foot.
No, it's not in the real sense.
Didn't use his upper body to help him down.
But it is
either.
A trip in the offensive zone, not a good penalty, and usually the ones that you shouldn't take that end up burning you, so we'll see what happens here. With the Penguins having to already have killed 4. Just leading by 1. Tavares is wide open on the near side. Puck over there. Martin able to pry it free, but it comes out the strike. Fakes the shot. And just pushes it towards the goal, and Orpik just cleared it away to center.
These guys are so smart. Tavares is so sneaky on that backside of the net. You know, Adams is thinking about him. Fleury's thinking about him. Wow.
Now he's got the puck.
Commands that respect, doesn't he?
Tavares works it down low to Boyes. Back from Molson. He was tied up, surrounded by Penguins. Now a high stick on the puck. Penguin high stick. They'll drop it to the left of Marc-Andre Fleury. We'll take a look at our UPMC Sports Medicine injury update.
Matt Niskanen, lower body. Saw him go down a couple weeks back and in 5 games, 3 points, 3 hits.
Strike. The Boyes. Molson's in the slot. Tavares works the corner. Around for Nielsen. Strike. For Molson. Shot it off the skate of Orpik. Dupuis over to get it. Martin stepped in there to work it along the boards. Orpik, good work to get there. Get it up so that Tanner Glass could shoot at the length of the ice. Great work by the Penguins penalty killers. Down to 46 seconds on the penalty to Chris Kunitz.
Awesome, awesome work. And they outworked the five Islanders who are working hard themselves.
Here's Kyle Okposo with it. Michael Grabner is back on the ice. Seems to be okay. Andy McDonald with a puck to the corner. Now behind the net. Okposo centers. Grabner there. Big save. Or will Letang may have blocked that right in front of Marc-Andre Fleury. Now it's Strike. Strike. Wanted to redirect from Grabner, but the Penguins' Dupuis has it. And Cooley slaps it the length of the ice. 16 seconds to go on the penalty.
Boy, the Penguins are really picking up assignments, picking up sticks.
Here's McDonald with it now. Throws it ahead to Grabner. Grabner turns away from Engelin. Try to get it to the corner. It hit the referee. 1 second to go on the penalty. Kamenik wants the puck. He'll get it now. Here comes Kunitz on the ice. Shot stopped by Fleury. Rebound. Kamenik pokes it back towards the corner. The coin goes in after it. And now it's sent back around near side where Engelin will take it for the Penguins. Ahead down to Brandon Sutter. Kunitz back on the ice. So the Penguins dodge that bullet. And they've killed all five Islander power play chances. And the Islanders were 0 for 7 in their last game against New Jersey. So they're now 0 for their last 12 on the power play. And here comes Matt Martin down the right wing. Against Portuzo. And he is checked. And Neal dumps it into the Islanders' zone. Straight goes back for it. Able to work it quickly up the near wall to Matt Martin. He's out here now with Colin McDonald. He dumps it past McDonald and Dupre to the corner. Bortuzzo back to get it. Bortuzzo and Dupre paired up. They played a lot together in Wilkes-Barre. Now Neal trying to get possession and the penalty coming up. A hooking penalty.
Boy.
And it is a march to the penalty box.
You need some WD-40 on that Penguins door. They've been in and out of that thing like way too much. They only have 10 shots on net in the hockey game. Despite all that, they still hold a one-goal advantage, 1-0 in the hockey game. There's the hook by Neal. Stick right up in the hands. James Neal will be in the box again.
Islanders managed one shot on their last power play, and Penguins did a great job. Now they'll have to do another great job. Here's Martin clearing to the line, held in by Strike. Strike to Tavares. As he tried to move it to the corner. Good work by Paul Martin. The Penguins are so focused on this Islander power play after what happened in Pittsburgh. Another block. Puck came through, though, and Fleury able to freeze it.
Great shutdown pair in Martin, Brooks Orpik. How great have they been this season? Look at the ice time, the hits and the blocks, and I don't know how they are able to play that way against top players and not take a penalty all season long in a game that's been penalty-filled again here. In this one, they have still yet to take a penalty. I know I've jinxed them. They're going to take one eventually. But that is some kind of hockey. That's special hockey. That's positional play, that stick on puck, that's lifting sticks in front of the net. It's almost boggling, mind-boggling to me that they can play that way and not have taken a penalty to this point.
1:22 to go on the penalty to James Neal as Franz Nielsen cruises over to the far wall. Straight at the center point. They try to go to one. It does come through. And he passes it right back over to Franz Nielsen. Molson, Boyes, and Tavares on for the Islanders. Paul Martin looks for the puck. It's loose behind the net. Molson centers in the wrong direction as Tavares went to the front of the net. But Strait's got it right back to John Tavares. Tavares has Nielsen across the ice. Can he get on the puck? Yes. And the shot taken was blocked and then Fleury over. Now Nielsen out to straight a blast. And that one was blocked by Brooks Orpik and he clears. Awesome work by the Penguins in front of Marc-Andre Fleury.
Oh, are they collapsing? Not just in the house to the top of the crease. You got four bodies there. The Islanders, they can't penetrate.
And we're seeing a little dose of what Penguins are have to deal with a lot. And that's that. Players just packing it in around the goal. Straight with a shot. Pad stop made by Fleury. 25 seconds to go on the penalty. Matt Cook's got it, and he dumps it down the ice.
Great stuff. You're going to have fresh legs. If you're not a penalty killer on the Penguins team, when you hop over the boards here, when you get the call, the tap, you got to be flying.
12 seconds to go on this penalty. Hamonic with it. He gets it right back. Look at all the white jerseys in the slot. And Fleury pokes it away. Another chance. Okposo lifted it wide of the goal and out of the goal. Penalty box comes James Neal. Here comes Letang. Letang cruising in. Trying to center one. And Andy McDonald did a good job to put his body down to block that centering pass, and now it's Oposo down the left wing. Dupree over to confront him, able to take him right to the wall. Good, hard defensive work there by Dupree. Casey Cizikas is jumped over there by the Penguins, and now Dupree's got it over to Letang. Ahead to Kunitz. Back for Dupree, a shot, he scores! What a shift for Simon Dupree, and the Penguins make it 2-0.
Simon Dupree, you gotta love him, folks. He just plays the game. He's all heart. Defensively on Oposo, he shut Oposo off down at the far end. He didn't sit and relish on that hit. He joined the rush, and he came late. Kunitz saw him, and he one-times the puck by the left pad and glove of Evgeny Nabokov, and Simon Dupree is bringing it on both ends of the rink.
I love how quickly he got rid of that puck. And that was the beauty of that. It was off his stick before he could blink your eye and in the net. And Kunitz and Letang pick up the assists. Letang has another point, getting closer to the top spot among defensemen scoring in the NHL. Up to within a couple of points of Toby Enstrom of the Winnipeg Jets.
And what can the Islanders be thinking right now? Umpteen chances to score in the power play. They get nothing. The Penguins come the other way.
I mean, you talk about turning defense into offense. That was a classic example of it right there.
I mean, it's great stuff right now. And the Penguins have withstood this storm, this rash of penalties, and just incredible, really.
Six power plays of the Islanders the Penguins have killed. And now they lead it 2-0. And Robert Bortuzzo over there defending along with Dupree to try to backhand it out. He does get it to Kunitz, who's able to backhand at the center ice.
Yeah, you remember in the first period, 13:45, they didn't get a shot. In the second period, they went 11 and a half minutes without a shot until Dupree got that one there. And Nabokov, he was probably a little bit sleepy down there.
And the thing is, Dupree has taken some penalties, but it hasn't seemed to deter him in any way. Here's Crosby into the slot. He shoots one over the goal, is off a stick.
No, and they keep putting him out there. That's what I like about this coaching staff, too. You know, you live with some of that with a young player, and the linesmen tend to call a young player a little bit more than a veteran. And they've allowed Dupree to kind of make his own way here in the National Hockey League.
And he is a big body, and you can see the way he took Oposo hard into the boards, that he is a guy who can really throw his weight around, and he's got a good, quick stick. And the Penguins, as a result, have a 2-0 lead in this game.
Week we profiled Western PA's JT Miller and his season with the Rangers' top affiliate in Connecticut. And yesterday, the 19-year-old was called up by the Blue Shirts and is on the ice tonight, not too far from here, as the Rangers battled the Devils in New Jersey, has clocked just under 9 minutes of ice time and has already fired 2 shots on goal. Best of luck to JT Miller tonight, guys.
Yeah, thanks.
And speaking
very much,
of stars.
Yeah.
Well, Simon Dupree, we were talking to him the other day about his shot, and I noticed that his wrist shot has been very effective. And he said that used to be one of my weaknesses. He says, I do a lot of shooting on the shooting room surface at Sol Energy Center. The Penguins have a room with an artificial surface that you can shoot on, and he fires pucks in there. He's gotten much, much better, he thinks, with his wrist shots. And, boy, that was a good example of it. He really ripped that puck. Pass to Bakov, and the Penguins lead 2-0 with 2:04 to go in the second period. Evgeny Malkin backhands it up into the Islanders' zone, and back to get it goes Travis Hamonic, number 3. Stolen away, though, Crosby to Malkin. He shot it just wide, or make that the Boychuk to Malkin, and Bakov's body down there, and now Malkin digging along the boards, and he tried to center it to Cook cutting in, and the Islanders go the other way. Look at Letang race back and get into defensive position to break up the rush of the Islanders, who make a change as the Penguins go the other way. Dupree and Letang pair it up again here for the Penguins. Tavares cuts into the middle. John Tavares shoots it off a stick. Settles in behind the goal.
Simon Dupree's stick, by the way. Stick on puck. Great job. And there's another defenseman leading the rush, Chris Letang.
Swinging wide down the left wing is Brandon Sutter. Trying to get around Streit. He pulls up in the corner. And Streit able to knock it up the right wing boards, where Brad Boies leaves it for Tavares. He slithers his way to center ice, hands it to Boies. Boies centers one. And good work again, Brandon Sutter, that time on Brian Streit, who jumped into the attack. Is that going to be a penalty?
I think it's going to be on Streit. I honestly believe that.
It is. You're right.
Yeah, because the Penguins came back, Sutter on it, and he wanted to play the puck and straight after having his stick lifted, grabbed the stick of Sutter. So great defense by Sutter. Wow. Take a look. He just put his head down at the end of a shift. He lifts the stick, and then he had his own stick held as he went to play that puck. So really a good call by the official there. One that could almost went the other way if the official's not on his game, but that was great stuff.
Straight holding the stick.
Penguins with a chance to make it 3-0 here before the end of the period. Crosby to Malkin.
And knocked away. Well, you get such a clear picture of how the power play can make a difference in a hockey game. And the Islanders' inability to score on 6 power play chances. Penguins had a power play goal from Neal early in the game that gave them the 1-0 lead. Now they have a chance to add to it again here. Chris Kunitz back to play at 34 seconds to go in the period.
Well, it really does take a team effort if you're going to kill this Islander power play. We've seen great saves by Fleury, great sticks lifted by the likes of Tanner Glass and Sutter, and of course, you know, other defensemen are using each other to get the pucks out of the zone.
Crosby tried to drop it off the Malkin. Gino tries to go to the net, goes right side. Neal with a shot and a save made. And down and behind the net, Neal pokes a 3 for Sidney Crosby. 10 seconds to go in the period. Crosby to Letang. Back to Sid. And Malkin on one knee shoots it. Didn't get a lot on it. Nabokov able to make the save, and the Islanders clear. And this power play for the Penguins will continue at the start of the third period. 59 seconds to go on the penalty to Brian Strait.
Guys, congratulations to Harvey Whitten in section 301.
And let us go now to Rob King and Jay Caulfield.
Thank you, Bob. Thanks very much. Welcome back into our brand new Root Sports Studios alongside Jay Caulfield. I'm Rob King. Jay, you take a look at that period. It was really a matter of weathering the storm. All the power play opportunities for the Islanders. Penguins able to kill them all off and then get the goal from Simone Dupre.
That's about it. I mean, really, you're killing off penalties, and that's the way it goes. I mean, they're calling it tight on Pittsburgh, and, you know, some nights you're going to have that. But Fleury strong, penalty killer strong. You know, you weather the storm, and they've done that and still have that 2-0 lead. Great play by Dupre on both ends of the ice. Guys finding each other. Again, a strong, strong effort.
We still have a lot more coming up with Jay Caulfield on our second intermission report presented by Mercedes-Benz. Jay will tell us straight. Dan Potash with a player interview, highlights from around the league as well when we return after this.
Now, Penguins intermission presented by Mercedes-Benz.
James Neal scored in the first. Simone Dupre scored in the second. The Penguins lead 2-0 as we welcome you into the second intermission report presented by Mercedes alongside Jay Caulfield. I'm Rob King of the pregame show. We were kind of having some fun with Stan Savard. Said, hey, maybe Simone Dupre will be interviewed by Dan Potash between periods. Well, he gets the goal, and now he gets the interview with Dan, brought to you by your Western PA Chevy dealers.
Well, long after the Penguins had left the ice for their morning skate, we still saw Simone Dupre out there working and working and working. I don't know if you were working on your shot. Maybe you were, because it certainly looked good out there on the ice.
Yeah, I was working on my shot. I wanted to be sure if I got an opportunity, I would be ready.
What else can you say about what this team has been able to do on the penalty kill tonight? The Islanders with 6 power play opportunities and have not really been able to get a sniff, if you will.
The guy's been great on the penalty kill. Flowers has been some big saves, and the second chances, the guy we're out boxing the guys out. Good blocking shots. We're doing a great job on the PK. We got to stay out of the box, so me, myself first. I got a few tonight.
Well, you made up for it with that goal. Well done.
Yeah, thank you.
Guys, it's all yours.
Dan, thanks very much. And Jay, when you look at Dupre, I mean, that shift showed you the kind of ability he had. He makes the play in the defensive end and then is able to join the rush in the offensive end and finish things off.
Yeah, the upside to a player like that. I mean, you just got to get him the more time, the more minutes players get, you know, when you shorten your leash, it makes it tough for any player. But a young player coming up, defense with the skill that he has, finishes off, physical, comes up, joins us, and yells for the puck. You can even hear him yell for it. So you like that. You like that in a player. Both he and Bertuzzo are handling himself very, very well and doing a great job and helping solidify a situation. The team's playing good. Good time to be playing. You know, it's a good time to be in a lineup when you're playing well and the team's on a roll. That's where you want to be.
Penguins looking for their 4th consecutive victory. We still have a lot more to come here on your second intermission report presented by Mercedes-Benz. Jay will tell us straight. We have highlights from around the league as well, all when we return after this.
This copyrighted telecast is presented by Root Sports under the authority of Pittsburgh Penguins LP.
This copyrighted telecast may not be reproduced, rebroadcasted, re-recorded, or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of Pittsburgh Penguins LP.
Welcome back to your second intermission report presented by Mercedes-Benz. Penguins leading the Islanders 2-0 down at Nassau Coliseum. Welcome back to our Roots Sports studio, and Jay Caulfield here to tell us straight. Jay, the power play really hit a rough patch after the start of the season great. Lately, it's been picking up. We saw the power play goal by James Neal, but we're also seeing, it seems, a lot more opportunities on the power play.
Yeah, and in this situation, this is after Sidney Crosby went down after getting hit with the puck, and you're going to see a different lineup. But for the most part, you still look for the same thing. You want to see if you can gain the zone smoothly, and then look how they set up and get one-timers. We're going to take a look at first. We're going to watch Malkin. You can let this go, boys. We're going to watch Malkin kind of roll up the ice. Hold it right here. You watch when he's coming up, as we mentioned, he's trying to bring the ice up, the puck up this way. But what you like is you're getting the guys going with speed. Everybody's going with speed. And you have our other guy that's up over here. It will be Tyler Kenny in this position. So when they come up the ice, they come with speed. You want to gain the zone. That's what you're looking to do, is gain the zone smoothly. Watch Kunitz come across right there. There you've got it. Freeze it right here. Once you gain that zone, this is a huge part of the play right here. Tyler Kenny's got to get by. Malkin's going to try and pick Nielsen. But for the most part, if Tyler Kenny makes this pass right here, it gives you all these opportunities. You can let it roll. Tyler Kenny gets it by. There's Neal going through. Freeze it right here. Once that happened, look right away how Letang, he's already opened up. He's already sees what's happening. He's opening up. Another guy you're going to look for, you're going to watch Malkin in this position right here. Well, we can't get that one, but we'll see. We're going to watch him open up as well. As I mentioned, Malkin's going to open up, and Neal is going to drive the net. So once he drives, there's three opportunities for Kunitz. He can shoot himself with traffic in front from Neal and Letang opening up. Let's watch what happens. You can see you want to get it in the wheelhouse right there. Freeze it again. That's the wheelhouse. Right? See how Letang is opening up? You need that puck to be in a certain area. Not too far back, not too far front ahead of him. It's right in the perfect spot. Here's where you get a good one-timer right there by Letang. Again, great neutral zone, great entry, great speed to the neutral zone. Once you gain that zone smoothly, you have a number of opportunities. And that displays that Kunitz did a great job, and he had three looks but chose Letang. Great opportunity.
One thing we didn't see, I think, Jay, is we take a look at our Westminster advantage brought to you by Westminster College. There's enough power play opportunities for the Penguins. Look how many power plays the Islanders had. Is that what sticks out to you here?
Yeah, obviously you have six. But the good thing about that, Rob, they've got six opportunities, and you know how they work in the NHL. They're going to try and even it up a little bit. Pittsburgh's going to get a couple opportunities. Hopefully they cash in and take that moment. Again, they're up 2-0. They've done a great job, but they're going to get their looks on the power play as well.
And the Penguins will begin that third period on the power play as well. Maybe a chance to pad that lead. Stick around. We have extended highlights coming your way when we continue on your second intermission report presented by Mercedes-Benz. The first period on the power play, Simone Dupre his second in the second, and the Penguins leading the Islanders by the score of 2-0. Special teams have been a huge part of this game. The Penguins able to solve that Islanders penalty kill that had only allowed two goals all season. Meanwhile, the Penguins' own penalty kill with Marc-Andre Fleury has been terrific. For more on that and the third period, let's go back to Nassau Coliseum and Steigie and Bob. Guys?
Thanks, Rob. Yeah, the best thing you can do is stay out of the box, Bobby, but if you're going to go in there, you got to kill it, and that's one thing the Penguins have really zeroed in on here tonight. I think they had a lot of respect for the Islanders' power play coming into the game.
Well, you know, if you look what the Islanders did, the first seven and the last two, their power play hasn't been as special, but the Penguins, yeah, they're playing a little bit of Tavares roulette right now. You don't want to really continue that way, but Brooks Orpik again with four block shots in this hockey game. You get in the lanes when the shot's coming. You don't engage until the puck comes off the pads of the netminder, and you keep yourself free and mobile, and the Penguins have done a great job of that.
And now the Penguins will try to get that power play working here early in the third period on the fresh ice surface. Straight to the box for another 49 seconds as Letang dumps it in and around to the near side where Nielsen couldn't get a stick on it. Crosby works it back to Malkin and back to Sid on the half wall. Malkin to the right point. Letang angles one towards Sid. Kunitz is in front of the net. Now he backs off, and Malkin's got to retreat to center. You got to watch out for Michael Grabner because he's out here killing the penalty for the Islanders. And he's a breakaway specialist. Now he just dumps the puck up into the Penguin zone. He had a breakaway the other day from his own blue line all the way to the net in a nothing-nothing game, and Johan Hedberg made a great save on him to keep the game scoreless, and then the Devils went on and won. And, of course, Grabner did score on a breakaway in Pittsburgh last week. The Penguins have to go back into their own zone with only 7 seconds to go on this penalty.
Letang to Malkin. Malkin just left it there, and Reisner.
Reisner had a man coming out of the penalty box there. If he was smart, he had a three-on-one going the other way.
Now Brandon Sutter sends it up the wall, and Thomas Hickey's shot went off a stick. It comes to Letang around for Matt Cook. It's a 2-0 Penguin lead. Fleury sweeps the puck to the near side. Tavares tried to get hold of it, couldn't do so. Tyler Kennedy able to make sure it gets out to center. Taken by Molson, slings it to the right side, and boys, to Tavares, it jumped off his stick at the Penguins' counter. Now they'll have a 2-on-1 if they hurry. Matt Cook has a man open. It's Sutter shooting. He scores! Brandon Sutter finishes the play, and the Penguins lead it 3-0.
Tremendous stuff. Working hard in their own zone. The Pittsburgh Penguins are able to turn the puck over. There the Islanders, a bouncing puck. Penguins coming back. And it's a 2-on-1. Brandon Sutter, after that pass from Matt Cook, has really only got one option. That's to shoot the puck. And it just gets in between the left arm and the body of Nabokov. Sutter's got 2 on the season.
And there's something about this ice surface for the Sutters, because that's 6 goals in 14 games against the Islanders for Brandon Sutter. He's had good numbers against them in his career. He gets excited, I'm sure, to play them. This is where his dad was a star for the Islanders. Now the puck dumped in on Nabokov. Of course, his uncle Dwayne played here as well. They used to call him Dog. That was his nickname, Dog Sutter. Nice. Tanner Glass with it. Puck loose at the side of the goal. Stays in play here. No whistle. The tally there. Battle continues, and finally Craig Adams has it. Adams dumps it rink wide. Robert Bortuzzo moves up. The Penguins looking for revenge here tonight on Long Island. And they get the 2-on-1. Cook feeds it to Sutter, who is able to shoot it off of Nabokov into the goal, and the Penguins lead it 3-0 here early in the third. Engelin shoots it. Nabokov the save. Nabokov now starting 8 of the 9 games the Islanders have played. A lead pass off the skate of Raposo. Just couldn't take it or he would have been gone. And now the Penguins go the other way. Boychuk overtaken by Grabner, but he's still got the puck deep. Going back to play it at strike for straight. And he's able to bank it off the boards. Good play to get it out. And now Grabner moves it to the right wing of Raposo. Back for Grabner. A good play by Dupre to put his body down and block it. But they score! Raposo somehow got that back off the rebound of the block by Dupre, I think, and put it in. Grabner was there to finish the play.
And it almost looked like when the puck came back to Raposo and then back to Grabner, that Grabner might have kicked it in almost. He had his skate behind his stick. Yeah. As it came to the front of the net, he had his left skate, in case it went over a stick, behind his stick, but it looked like it hit the stick and not the skate. I guess there's no question there. They'll take a look in the situation room, but it did indeed look like it went off the blade, the stick blade of Grabner, and the Islander respond just like that.
I thought Dupre had made a great play, Bob, but the puck ended up getting back through him again.
He did.
The rebound came off the block play. Now Molson swipes it one and fanned on it. Here's Kunitz down the wing. Crosby busting to the net. Oh, he almost got off the puck. Crosby's stick was lifted. And a slap shot taken by Dupuis. It was stopped by Nabokov. And Tavares sends it ahead down to Brad Boys. Boys, Tavares, and Molson come ahead. Boys slaps one through the slot all the way out to the point and strike. Mark Streit dumps it in deep. Molson centered one quickly. Comes all the way through. Straight with a drive and a save made by Fleury. Rebound, backhand shot, score. Brad Boys makes it 3-2 just like that.
Sidney Crosby's talking to the official now. He wanted a call on Brian Streit. The Penguins had a great opportunity. Nabokov robbed Pascal Dupuis. What a glove save he made. It would have been 4-1, and the Islanders come the other way. This is where Crosby wanted a penalty. Look at that stick up into the hands. Crosby had a wide open cage on the backside. It comes the other way, and a big fat rebound is shuffled into a wide open net. Forehand to backhand, Boys, who scored 43 goals and 33 goals with the Blues. in consecutive years. A timeout now for the Pittsburgh Penguins. It's a 3-2 hockey game, but you could clearly see the stick of straight into the hands of Sidney Crosby. And then there was another save made by Nabokov right after that sequence off his glove hand that gave his team a chance to make it 3-2. So two goals in 35 seconds, and we have a ton of time here. This game has been up and down.
There's Brad Boyes. He's moved around in his career. He was originally drafted by the Toronto Maple Leafs. The Penguins almost had him. They were offered Brad Boyes for Robert Lang when Lang was going to become an unrestricted free agent, and the Penguins turned down the deal. Didn't want to do it. They kept Lang past the trade deadline, and then he ended up hurting his hand and not helping the team at all down the stretch. And the Penguins missed a chance to make a deal for a former first-round pick. He ended up scoring a lot of goals, but he has had his issues because he's inconsistent, up one year, down the next. And he's looking to have an up year this year with the Islanders. Brad Boyes scoring his third goal of the season. Make it 3-2. There's a shot and a save by Fleury. The rebound behind the net. Derek Engelin comes out of the pack and is able to use the glass to get it out to center. Boys from Molson and McDonald. Assisted by 26 Molson, 47 McDonald. Straight with a long lead pass. Molson offside on the play. We want to remind you to enjoy a cold one and look forward to Miller Time later in tonight's game, brought to you by Miller Lite. Ryan Strait gets the second assist now. They change it on the play. So it's Molson and Strait assisting on the goal by Boyes.
So Strait made the play on Crosby in front of his own net and was able to get in on the offensive action.
Paul Martin cutting in. Martin turns the corner, throws it in front. Vitali's there, and he couldn't jam it home. Back to the point. Shot by Adams. Goes sailing wide of the net and off the glass. Adams was covering up for Martin, who had carried the puck in deep on the play. Now Tanner Glass with it. He'll feed it to the corner, and Adams will go in and get it against Thomas Hickey. Hickey jostled him into the boards. Tanner Glass also hit there, that time by Matt Carpenter, whose name we haven't called much tonight. He hasn't played a lot. And now the puck taken by Brooks Orpik. Backpedaling as Brad Boyes applies some pressure. He finds his partner, Paul Martin, and ahead to Joe Vitale. And we got ourselves a hockey game here as Grabner tries to steal. The lead pass off the stick of Zach Boychuk. It is taken now by Hickey. And Thomas Hickey tried to pass it ahead. It went off the skate of James Neal and Letang over to clear it back to center ice.
Yeah, Matt Kartner's a guy, a tough and rumble guy, but it's not going to provide you much offense. And he's only played eight shifts in this game, just under 6 minutes.
This is Nielsen with a shooting. Ouch, that hit Letang, but no worse for wear as the puck comes to James Neal. Grabner bumped him, but he got the puck towards the corner. Nevertheless, the Islanders' McDonald back, and he slings it all the way up and down the ice. This is going to be an icing call against the Islanders.
Again, Bosma called the timeout. Wanted to settle things down a little bit with the two goals in 35 seconds. And he, you know, what he would say at that point is just, let's get the puck to the red line, get it deep. A lot of what the Penguins do is, you know, it goes along the lines with their puck management and what they think about where they should put pucks in the offensive zone and how they should get the opposition defense to turn and go retrieve pucks and how they should attack that way and where they should have their F3 forward so they don't get caught in odd man situations. So try to slow things down and get a breather.
Nielsen comes ahead now for the Islanders. And he zigged one and zagged one too many times in the offside call against New York. A one-goal game now with a lot of time left in the third period. Day Automotive brings you, it's a great day for hockey, and it was a great day. And Chris Kunitz racked up four goals on four shots, the second Penguin in history to do so. Mario Lemieux did it on New Year's Eve of 85-86. He got his first hat trick that night. In fact, he got four goals, as he said, and Mike Bullard also scored three goals for the Penguins that night, and I think it was a 7-4 win for the Penguins over the Blues. And Chris Kunitz now in the Penguin record books. Pretty amazing. Talk about shooting percentage, Bob. That's pretty good.
Yeah, he didn't even have to shoot the first one. He just deflected it. But it's counted as a shot on net.
Brian Strait tried to pass it ahead to Strait, and he comes off a skate and right to Grabner, who drives it hard around. Fleury couldn't stop it. Now
right, he'll go back and play it.
Well, you don't want to play roulette with this power play of the Islanders in a 3-2 hockey game. You want to play very disciplined right now. They've had enough chances, and you killed six.
Crosby centers one. It goes bounding out towards the point of Letang. How about with Sid there to strike? I don't know if he's caught that, Bob, but he faked like he was going to pass the puck. And Strike went right by him, and he just kept skating with the puck. It was amazing. Just a little look that he gave. He completely fooled Strike there as he went over to challenge him on the far boards.
Well, Rabner, we can get into all the little subtleties that he does on the ice. We'd be here all day writing a novel.
Absolutely. You're straight with it. And now Grabner. Brad Boys takes it. Spins away from Kunitz. Right to center. And it goes off a skate. Back out to Mark Strike. Letang tried to clear it. It comes right back to Simon Dupre. Look at him skate. Set it up the boards, but the Islanders got it. Threw it back to the middle. Dupuy came back to cover up and make sure it got out to center ice.
Now those are the pucks you want off the glass in a one-goal hockey game for Simon Dupre. Get the puck high off the glass. Let your wingers do the job like that. Letang, off the glass and out.
Dupre over to get it again. That time he threw it up
there
off the glass and out.
Beautiful.
So he's
play.
Listening to you, Bobby.
Yeah, well, that's simple hockey, and that's exactly what the Penguins are looking for from Simon Dupre. Hey, he's provided some magic in this game, but 3-2 with 12 minutes left. You don't need any more.
Tyler Kennedy with Sutter trailing. Shoots it. Blocker save made by Nabokov. A good one. Matt Cook to the rebound. Hooks it free for Tyler Kennedy. Back out now to Derek Engelin. Now TK to Cook. A drive and a save made by Nabokov with Sutter standing right there. That's another good aggressive save by the goaltender. And the Penguins will look for another win against Ovechkin and company when they play host to the Caps this Thursday at Consol Energy Center. And we will have it for you, the Penguins and Capitals, Thursday starting at 6:30 right here on Root Sports.
I love the way the Penguins, with that F3 forward so high, you get into that open space. That time was Matt Cook to get an opening. Good hard shot on Nabokov who read the play, but that's what a lot of teams are using, that high zone to gain opportunities.
There's a real soft area there with a bigger offensive zone you have now. The blue line has been moved out when they took the red line out after the last lockout. And now teams are trying to take advantage of that little soft area because everybody's packing the house, right, Bob?
That's it. You know, the circle's down. Everybody's packed in there. Why not use your defense and that third guy up there instead of cycling down low? More like a high cycle, if you will.
I noticed the Kings doing a lot of that in the finals last year with great success.
And you have your F3 forward in great position if it doesn't work out for you.
Now back to get it is Brooks Orpik, and it came right between his legs, and it's taken by Marty Riesner. Centering pass comes all the way through. The Penguins couldn't get a stick on him, and it's Hickey dodging back and forth. He's able to get the puck to Cizikas, and his shot is blocked away. Brooks Orpik trying to get a hold of that bouncing puck. Now off the wall, Adams is smothered by Riesner. But Tanner Glass snaps it along for Paul Martin, and he banks it off the boards to center. And Kartner right there dumps it right back into the Penguins zone.
Another block shot by 44, Brooks Orpik.
Paul Martin glides ahead, feeds it for Malkin. Malkin trying to pass it to Neal. It comes to the Islander defense, straight to straight and up the right wing. Racing in after it is Ullstrom. Martin sends it up the near wall for Neal. He and Malkin get so close together, they support one another all the time. Malkin leaves it for Neal, and he'll dump it in. It's one of the things that Boychuk was told by Dan Bylsma, how much those two guys will come over real close to you to get the puck. Ullstrom with it will dump it to the right wing. The bouncing puck goes past McDonald. And now Keith O'Coin just feeds it in behind the Penguin goal where Chris Letang storms back. And Letang sees some room and he'll take it. Letang tried to get it to the net. It rolls to Nabokov. And Brian Strait carries it for the Islanders. Great, looking good as he drives it to the Penguin goal, and it's gloved down by Fleury. He'll hang on to it. And we'll be back in a moment.
Well, the play of Dupre maybe allowed them to move straight to the Islanders.
Miller time, brought to you by Miller Lite.
There's a big hit, Simon Dupre. And then he followed up ice, joined the rush, made a 3-on-3, a 4-on-3, and ripped it by Nabokov.
And now the Penguins really have to play solid D the rest of the way. They have six shots in this period, a five for the Islanders. Crosby looks for the puck. Kunitz has it. Feeds it for Sid. Out to the point in Brooks Orpik. Now to Martin. Try to wrist it to the goal. Blocked by Boise. He gets it back. The shot deflected right through the paint by Crosby. And in behind the box. On centering pass, Dupuis chips one. That's off a stick and up into the netting.
Orpik and Martin. Very wide on the blue lines. Board-to-board pass. Martin got the puck back. Shot it towards the net on a second attempt and was redirected just to the blocker side of Nabokov. Right there. Way out high by Chris Kunitz got the deflection. Initially, I thought it might have been Dupuis in tighter. Oh, what a save right off the faceoff. Sutter, Brandon Sutter, won a clean draw to Matt Cook, who just ripped it. And the Nabokov made a big save to keep it 3-2. Wow. Look at this. Down to one knee, Matt Cook.
You gotta be ready. Penguins like to set those plays up off the draws. And Nabokov was ready. Sutter again. And the Islanders control as Oposo on the draw. He goes to the bench. Ahlstrom sends it down the ice.
Offside, I believe.
Yep, they're going to bring it back here with 9:14 to go. And the goal that's the difference right now is the one by Brandon Sutter.
The Islanders were in ahead of that puck. So it'll come all the way down. It has to come to a face-off circle, and it does. So Sutter looking behind him, looking behind him. Who knows? He might go forward one of these times.
Keith O'Coin will take the faceoff of the Islanders. Out he goes. David Ahlstrom, a fourth-round pick in 2008. And the Islanders control again, and Andy McDonald. O'Coin to the right wing. McDonald's shot off the stick wide of the net, and then behind the net, Colin McDonald and Andy McDonald on the ice for the Islanders. As Matt Cook ices the puck.
They've already used their timeout, the Penguins, so if they have tired troops on the ice, they're going to have to leave them. Time now for our Subway sandwich of the game. It'll be Matt Cook early in the game. Yeah, this is really early. Boy, he sent Cartner flying. I thought that might have been payback for a shot that Cartner applied on Matt Cook in the last game.
Straight able to get the puck to the goal, and it floats right to the belly of Marc-Andre Fleury. And we'll get another faceoff in the Penguin zone.
Yeah, that puck went anything but straight into the belly of Marc-Andre Fleury. It was a little chip shot over everybody, a little Texas looper.
Tavares takes the draw against Sutter and wins it cleanly back to Brian Strait. His shot never got through. We'll say that a lot. A lot of shots get blocked today in the NHL. You try to shoot from the point. Here's Strait with it now. His shot blocked. Brandon Sutter over to get it, and he pokes it out to center.
Well, Sutter is so good working down with the defense. So when you talk about a shutdown pair, you're talking about Orpik and Martin for the Penguins here against the top unit of the Islanders. But you have to throw Brandon Sutter in that line into the mix. And look at Sutter. He's just right in the middle of that defensive triangle between the hash marks there. And he's blocked three or four in this game. He's won big draws. He scored a big goal here. The go-ahead goal so far that if it stands, will be the winner. I mean, tremendous hockey player.
Hickey over to Cartner. Boyce shoots it to the goal. To the corner. Tavares slithers away from Brooks Orpik. Tavares trying to move in front. Molson had a stick in there, but out to the point it comes to Hickey, and he'll wrist it in behind the goal. Boyce is there again. Boyce, Molson, and Tavares. Tavares set it below the goal line. Then he goes in and tries to get it away from Paul Martin, who stuck with it to get it out to the right wing. And now Adams chases after it, but Matt Kartner turns and fires it up for Molson. It was a grenade he threw there. And back to get the puck goes Paul Martin, and the Islanders change as they... Penguin right winger Adams looked at it inside the line. Hickey sends it right back out to center. There's Craig Adams again along with Tanner Glass. Adams and Glass team up to get it just inside the line. And now Kartner will go back for the puck deep in his own zone. Sends it around for Hickey and right back for Kartner. Malkin's on the ice now. Now comes James Neal. And
And Simone Dupre turns and finds a little opening to slip it deep into the Islanders' zone. 7:20 to go in the game. Raposo takes the puck and turns it back to neutral ice, and Grabner's after it. Grabner got a step on Letang. Centers. He didn't shoot it, and it was blocked. Malkin came back, and Nielsen was going to the net there, and the puck never got to him.
And he just took a punch in the schnoz by Chris Letang. And I tell you, Grabner, his speed, he could have taken that puck to the net. He used the back of his skate to kick it up, and in one stride, he looked like he was going to go by Letang, but then he stopped and looked for a trailer.
I don't know what happened to him there. Letang got him. Here comes Olsen to the goal, and he pushed it just wide. He had Fleury going the other way and just missed it. Now Hamonic trips, and the Penguins want to take advantage of that. Zach Boychuk dumps it softly to the right wing corner. 6:35 to go. Penguins up by one. Danny McDonald, lead pass off the stick of Keith O'Coin to the Penguin zone. And Englund gets back and touches up to get the icy call. McDonald's on his knees right now. He's hurt.
McDonald went down. Grabner went down. It is tough sledding right now. Chris Kunitz is going to the box. So behind the play, somebody caught what happened.
And we'll give you a look right now at what happened. There's the pass. McDonald was admiring his pass. Kunitz actually even stopped and just hit him with his rear end. Don't take a look at it. Watch Letang. He just bowls over Grabner, and as he goes down, his stick goes right up into the facial area of Grabner.
Two hands on the stick he kept, and Grabner, was chewing on some wood.
It's tough out there right now.
How about Chris Kunitz? Talk about a guy that can throw a body check. He's going to get an interference penalty for a little bit late hit, but man, can he throw a hip into a guy? And really, he's just like a cannonball, a human cannonball.
There's a, what, is that the fourth interference we've seen?
Yeah.
And so there you go. McDonald was admiring his pass up the right wing. 6:28, and it is tough sledding out there right now.
Now, the Penguins have done a phenomenal job. They've killed six Islander power plays. The Islanders have registered 13 shots out of the 30 that they have with a man advantage, and now they have a golden chance here to tie this game. Sometimes it's not how many, but it's when you score them, and they can tie the game now with one power play goal. There's a shot by Strait, and a stick save by Fleury, and the puck up into the net.
You know, you mentioned the shots they have, but the Penguins have blocked 16. Half of those have come on the Islander power plays.
Definitely.
I mean, and they're going to have to block more here. That one there, Marc-Andre Fleury just puts up into the netting. So, big face-off. Crosby's out for it.
Now it's Strait with it. Strait, Nielsen, Molson's in the slot. Tavares works the half boards. His shot, Molson there. Martin and Fleury went down to keep it out of the net. And Sidney Crosby killing the penalty for the Penguins along with Cook. Able to backhand it down the ice. Well, Sid will go to the bench.
Martin was draped all over Molson, and Molson couldn't elevate the puck. It was a big save by the right pad of Fleury, but give Martin a lot of credit for just being right on Molson.
Brad Boys with it behind the net. Nielsen couldn't make anything happen back there, and the Penguins will send the Islanders back into their own zone. Strait goes back to get it with 56 seconds to go on the penalty to Kunitz. Tavares had it poked away by Tanner Glass. Penguin penalty killers are like demons here tonight. Here's Tavares. Now Grabner. Can he skate? My goodness. Centers one for O'Coin. Not the strike. Now to Hamonic. His slap shot wide of the goal. Off the corner boards to strike. O'Coin gives it away. Dupuy read the play beautifully. Now he wants to try to get around Hamonic if he can. Hamonic back with a puck. And Dupuy will just spin back. And in tandem, he and Craig Adams will try to kill the rest of this penalty. Now Dupuy goes to the bench. And Matt Cook dumps it back inside the Islander zone. Not much time left on this power play. The Islanders down by one, have 8 seconds to work with. Maybe one more rush if they hurry. Here goes Grabner. Michael Grabner has a man open on the wing. Couldn't get on the puck. Good defensive work by the Penguins. Kunitz on the ice. Down the wing comes Adams. A shot and the buck out the save. The rebound picked up by Keith O'Coin. Kunitz with fresh legs. Gets over and takes the puck away from him. And now Grabner bangs it off the boards to center. Rolling on the ice was Kunitz to get himself onside as the puck is dumped in. Crosby back to the net. Stick save to Bakov. Kunitz sets it up. And a good read there by Matt Martin to pick off the pass intended for Tyler Kennedy. Kyle Okoso down the wing. Curls. Looks back. And now dumps it to the corner. Fortuzzo hit by Matt Martin, but he got the puck up the wall for Simone Dupre. And he finds Tyler Kennedy. Kennedy into the Islander zone. Left it there for Kunitz. Back for Kennedy. It's in his feet. Crosby reaches for it. Sends the puck back around to the left wing corner for Kunitz. Brian Strait bumps Kunitz. Crashing in there to play the puck with Sidney Crosby. And now the Islanders. Matt Martin will take it deep in his own zone. Penguins are changing as the Islanders try to come ahead. Dogged work by Tyler Kennedy keeps the puck in the Islander zone.
Not many whistles. 0 for 7. The Islanders power play. 16 shots.
More good work by Kennedy. He got the puck to Boychuk. Out here with Malkin. And now Neal joins. He comes off the bench. Zach Boychuk works the corner. Malkin there as well. He finds Paul Martin at the point. Martin distributes it back behind the net to Evgeny Malkin. Now Malkin try to go to Boychuk, but the Islanders break it up. Good work down there. And look, James Neal with a back pressure. Great work by James Neal. He just tracked down Tavares on that play. Now Tavares feeds it for Molson. And up the right wing, Neal. Let it go for Malkin. It's poked off his stick by Strait. Molson sends it to the right wing. There's a man open. It's Boys. Top shot, and Fleury makes the save.
Oh, a tough save on a rolling puck.
2:36 to go in the game. The Penguins up by one. Tavares closes in. A shot off the stick of Paul Martin. Fleury reaching behind the net. Boys has it now. Off of the point. Hamonic. Slap shot. Puck on edge, and it went wide. Straight to the puck now. He sends it in behind the goal. Tavares is there. Molson's in front. The pass off a skate. Boys tries to get it. Penguins want to get it out. Boys works it to the corner for Tavares. Not Tavares. Try to go to the point. Hamonic able to keep it in. Brad Boys lassos it behind the net. And now Paul Martin over. Can he get it out? He does get it back to center ice. The Penguins need to make a change if they can. Hook and Neal on the ice. Strait lost his stick. He picks it up. And here comes Franz Nielsen now. Left it on the right wing for Michael Grabner. Letang reaching in for it. Nielsen leans on him. And they work it free. For Joe Vitale on his horse right now. Vitale busting down that off wing. Center sort of went off the leg. It was intended for Sutter cutting to the goal. And now the Islanders. Michael Grabner skates to the puck. Nowhere to go as he backhands it up into the Penguins zone. Down to a minute 25. We'll keep our eye on Nabokov.
Hit the official, a clear attempt to clear by the Penguins. See if they can get it out in the second crack, and they do. Tanner Glass on his backhand. Not an easy play. Great job there by Tanner Glass.
Franz Nielsen takes it now. Nabokov going to be coming out of the net. The Islanders can't get it deep. Nabokov's going to go back in the goal. Sidney Crosby with the puck. He's got Dupuis cutting to the net. Crosby turns around. Hamonic strong on his skates right now. Crosby, great play. Moves it along for Dupuis, who steps out. His shot. Nabokov the save. And Nabokov can't come out of the net. The Penguins keep the Islanders pinned in their zone. Now Molson takes the lead pass. And finds Tavares, but he can't handle it. Martin sends it ahead. Nabokov's out of the net. Dupuis shoots, and he scores. Pascal Dupuis finishes the job for the Penguins. They're up by two with 39 seconds to go. What a play. What an effort by the Penguins to keep the Islanders in their half of the rink and not enable them to get into the Penguins zone with the extra attacker.
Yeah, great gap by Paul Martin, who stood up on John Tavares. He forced him to make a play. Ill-advised. He mishandles the puck off his skate. Martin chips it up to Dupuis. And the game's over right there. But it was all penalty killing tonight, my friend. 0 for 7 were the Islanders on the penalty kill. And you can start with Marc-Andre Fleury. You can go right through the lineup. Every one of those players that went out, sacrificed, did the job, cleared pucks, blocked shots, lifted sticks, won faceoffs. A heroic effort.
That's two games in a row that the Islanders have gone 0 for 7 with a man advantage. The puck goes back into the Islanders zone. They were living on their power play early, and now they're dying by it because they all they needed was one to tie this game. And they couldn't get one because the Penguins just were phenomenal at killing penalties tonight. Down to 7 seconds to go. Robert Bortuzzo softly dumps it up into the Islanders zone. Now we have a confrontation. Matt Martin involved with Derek Englund as they allow the clock to tick away. So the Pittsburgh Penguins
get a little revenge here tonight. The Islanders beat the Penguins last week in Pittsburgh 4-1. Tonight, the Penguins return the favor and defeat the New York Islanders. Marc-Andre Fleury is our McDonald's player of the game in a 4-2 Penguins win.
It's 16 power play shots, so yes, indeed. It was Marc-Andre Fleury and the players in front of him, and most everybody was used on this whole club. It took a lot of moxie to get through this one. It was a lot of ups and downs, and boy, that was a battle of in the trenches in the third period.
We will return to Long Island in just a moment. We'll wrap things up from here. The Penguins defeat the Islanders tonight, 4-2. They've won four in a row.
You can't skate like they do. You can't hit like they do. You can't shoot like they do. But you can get treated by some of the same doctors, physical therapists, and sports medicine experts just like they do.
It's rewarding to see the results.